I believe that everybody has a story, and I'm fascinated to hear them. So come with me as we take a walk down Fascination Street. Hey, Streetwalkers. Keep listening after the episode for the first 5-minute episode of Subterra, a scripted science fiction podcast written by Warren Davis and Steven Kruger and narrated by Marty Yu. Welcome back, Streetwalkers. This episode is with photographer and director Jeremiah Chechik. Jeremiah is the director of such films as National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, Benny and June, Diabolique, The Avengers, not the one you're thinking of, and a ton of television, including Gossip Girl, The Gifted, Rogue, The Glades, Heart of Dixie, Leverage, Chuck, just a ton. In this episode, we talk about where Jeremiah grew up and what got him sort of into the artistic bent. He tells us wonderful stories about becoming a fashion photographer and moving to Italy and all this crazy cool stuff. And then finally, how he ended up working his way over here to America and getting into filming commercials, movies, and television. We also talk about his podcast, The Future of Photography, what it's about, who he does it with, and where you can find it. We cover a lot of ground in this episode, so pay attention, and who knows, he might be on again because we didn't even come close talking about how fascinating Jeremiah is. This was recorded during all the self-distancing due to the coronavirus outbreak. So if that is over by now, woohoo. If not, damn it. But either way, this is my conversation with Jeremiah Chechik. Yeah, talk to me, yeah. Welcome to Fascination Street Podcast, Jeremiah Chechik. How are you doing today, Jeremiah?
No improvement, but I have set the bar rather high, so I'm holding my own. I'm okay.
Fantastic. Are you quarantined right now due to whatever the hell's going on?
Not officially, but psychologically, yes. Quarantine. It's massively rainy today in Venice, California. Unusual. And as I've been practicing social distancing, for those of you listening to this in the deep future, this will be somewhat nostalgic, we hope, should we all survive.
No shit.
But so far, so good. Using a tremendous amount of hand sanitizer, though.
Yeah, in Venice, you probably just filled your pool full of sanitizer and just take a dip every now and then, right?
Yeah, should I have a pool? I would do that. We have a beach. It's much harder to fill the ocean with it, though. So,
oh, come on, dude. Try harder. All right. So, Jeremiah, we're going to talk about you. So why don't you sort of walk us through, you know, where you grew up?
Is this like the origin story?
Yeah, well, we're going to start there and then we're going to meander. I like to start where people grew up and kind of get a sense of sort of how they were funneled into their particular profession and or hobbies and careers and stuff like that. So where were you born and raised, Jeremiah?
I was born in Montreal, Quebec, Canada. Grew up there in a area that was basically mixed English, French, and lots of kind of formerly Eastern European Jews. And it was a whole mixed bag there growing up. You know, I lived with my uncles and my grandfather and my grandmother. We all had not a big house, but a nice big family. So I grew up there. Both my parents worked. And I never really thought of myself as a, quote, creative person, but just kind of hopped along. As my education at high school was very, you know, in the days when you could actually learn something in high school, the educational levels were pretty good. I studied Latin, I studied science, did a lot of physics, and graduated young, probably when I turned 16. I graduated and I was very kind of focused on science. I went to McGill University, which some may know. It's one of those Canadian Ivy League universities. We don't have many, but that was one. I had applied to Berkeley, I applied to Yale, I got in, but I couldn't afford to go, so there I was. By the time I was 16, I was pretty well living on my own, for reasons I won't go into, but it was the 60s, and so while I was registering at McGill, I noticed that all the real cool people, all the interesting girls, all the interesting guys, were in the line for bachelors of art. And here I was, bachelor of science, engineering. And at the last second, I swapped lines. Because I had a scholarship, I had to take a few science courses, which I did, on genetics of all things. And I did some mathematics courses, but really had the opportunity of being taught by many, many draft dodgers, effectively, many from New York, both in theater and literature. And that really, I think, were very formulative in my approach to storytelling, literature, opening that whole world. And of course, the culture at that time, you know, kind of supported that both globally and whatnot. I managed to travel extensively between the ages of 16 and 19 when I graduated, or 20. But by that time, I think my artistic bent, or my sense of survival as a creative person, and by that I mean if you are making something today that didn't exist yesterday, that was fulfilling enough for what I thought then was a great life. And it pretty much turned out that way for me. The interesting thing was, never really lost my desire to learn science, certainly turned my back on math. I can't add, I'm very poor at that. But mathematics as a philosophical or physics-oriented study is something that I still am fascinated by. And, you know, in my kind of formative years then, again, living by myself, and there was a great political unrest in Quebec at that time. There was a big separatist movement, and kind of chaos ensued without getting into the kind of weeds of everything I did then. But I left for Toronto and got involved quite by accident in a theater group and signed up to act. I had studied theater at McGill, so I was familiar with the kind of overall sensibility. At that time, the Canadian government was giving all kinds of grants to local theaters, and friends of mine were running one. So I managed to kind of hop on as a spear carrier in Royal Hunt of the Sun and fell in love with a leading lady. And that was enough to keep me there. And through my affiliations there, stumbled into the art scene extensively there, worked with some people I'm still friendly with now, and we formed a gallery called A Space. And I remember, you know, we would have performance art and all kinds of exhibitions. At that point, we even hosted one of the very earliest performances of the Talking Heads. They were at the Rhode Island School of Design, I think, and brought them in, and they played at a party in a few other places. And so it was really the art scene that really gave me, you know, the juice to kind of keep on keeping on, as it were. Technically, though, I really fell in love with photography. And again, it was kind of in my DNA, because my father had a record store and had a photo studio in the back and grew up with a lot of different cameras, though I couldn't say I was particularly adept at using them, but they were sort of a familiar trope for me. When I began studying photography on my own and in depth, that really, really was transformative in my life and led to everything that really I became up to now. And that was an accident of some arena of my survival that forced me to stay in a single apartment for about 30 days, self-isolation, anyone? In preparation for that, I bought every book that was available. Of course, it was before the internet, all that. I bought every book available on photography, bought an enlarger, camera, film, and literally every day I would just take pictures of my hand, go into a little closet, load the film canisters into the developing tank. And, you know, the first time I did it, it seemed very dark, and all of a sudden it was struggling to put the film in, and all of a sudden I could see my hands, realize you have to cut every little bit of light in there. Finally figured that out. And by the time I came out 30 days later, I knew how to print. And, you know, one thing led to another. I became quite a, I think, a very good printer, because one of my very early jobs was at the University of Toronto Rare Book Library, where I worked as an assistant in a absolutely dazzling $1 million darkroom, printing glass negatives archivally. Very, very big mechanics, became very adept at that. And I never lost that kind of love of printing, which in many ways has informed what kind of photographic work I'm doing now. That's the kind of precursor to me.
Gotcha. It's a lot to cover there. So you mentioned storytelling at the beginning of that. Did you ever write stories?
Yes, I wrote. I still write, though I never considered myself, in effect, a writer. Writing was always a very important exercise. Not that I journaled or anything, but I did write, and I did start writing, I guess, when I really began thinking about what film directing would mean to me. Now, you know, in Canada at that time, there were very few roads to follow if one wanted to pursue a career in photography outside of, you know, just being a wedding photographer or whatnot. But I made the decision quite early on through a lot of encounters with famous people like Warhol and whatnot. And that encouraged me to, you know, move to New York, which I did, and kind of sublimated there. I went back and forth from New York to Toronto and eventually had applied for permanent residency. When I was in Toronto, though, I did begin shooting commercially, and that happened almost by accident. I had done a solo show at a gallery, and it was quite successful, and one of the people who came to the show, bought some work, was someone who was kind of very high up in the McCann-Erickson food chain, who happened to be in Toronto from South Africa at that time, and really fell in love with my work. God knows why, but he did. And a few weeks after the show, I got a call, and he'd asked me to come into the agency, which I'd never stepped foot in an advertising agency. I thought that would be a good adventure. And he introduced me to his writing partner, and he said, would you consider doing a project for us in the style of the work that you presented at the gallery? You know, we'll pay you X. And of course, I almost fell off my chair, but kept cool since he was offering me more money than I made in the entire year before. I did say yes. So I did these images at the studio, and they were all delighted. And that was that. I thought, well, that's kind of fun, sort of an amalgamation of commercial sensibility, trying to justify the purity of art at that time. I saw them as very distinctive. Well, what happened is he had an assistant that had a freelance job, and it was a fashion job. And his assistant had asked this man, did he know a photographer that would work cheap and be able to recreate certain images from a period in fashion, Perel style? And he said, yeah, I just work with this guy. He's kind of, you know, downtown, funky studio, in a cool situation, and won't charge you a lot. So he asked me to do a series of about 8 pictures, all in the style of George Harrell, who is a, you know, wonderful stylist, I think in the 30s, amazing photographer, very kind of single source lighting, very evocative, very beautiful still. His work is very resonant now. So I studied Harrell and lighting and that period. And of course, I bought every issue of Italian Vogue, a French Vogue, American Vogue, studied the pictures, really had a sense of what was expected of me. And then, you know, the day arrived and these gorgeous women showed up with a bevy of makeup, hair, and stylists in my funky loft and began to put this all together. And I had rented equipment, because I certainly didn't have much, and shot these pictures, and, you know, and I printed them, and I delivered them, and they seemed happy, and that was that. Never really thought much about it. Well, about 8 months later, I was walking down the street, and I looked up at a billboard, and might I say that the deal that I made, because they paid me so little, was that I would get a photo credit. So my name would be small, but on the side of every photo. And they said, sure, we'll do that. Sort of a European, it was for an Italian designer, and they were kind of used to that. Well, I looked up at this billboard, and there was this image that I had taken. Wow. And my name was like, you could read it on the side. And then not a moment later, a bus drove by with the same image on the side of the bus, and then happened into a magazine stand, and the back covers of magazines had the image. Well, by the time I got back to my loft, my phone was ringing off the hook. People thought, who's this new fashion photographer? And evidently it was me. So I decided I'd get serious. This could be a great source of income and a lot of fun. So I began a process wherein I really analyzed the kind of images that I wanted to make as an artist and how that integrated into commercial fashion photography, or editorial fashion photography, really, because there is a distinction. And off I went, kind of doing test shots, and I phoned the modeling agencies, and I was kind of a local celebrity then by that time because of my images being kind of plastered everywhere. And so I started to put together a portfolio of test prints, and I would use makeup artists, many of whom have become quite famous and stylists, and said, listen, just help me go to local designers. I'll give them the prints. The makeup artists can use my work for their portfolio. And we all kind of put a little cabal together. And out of that cabal started to grow real work. And not long after that, I was sent to Milan to photograph Gianni Versace's first collection and Giorgio Armani's earlier collections, and had met with them. They weren't near the kind of mythic figures they are now, but they were very famous then. And they gave me their studios to work, and they were extraordinarily generous. They introduced me to the modeling agencies. And at the agency, I remember the agency was called Ricardo Guy. Anyway, they said, you know, have you been to see Vogue? And I was like, wow. I'm just starting here. Oh, no. You got to go see them. They'll love your work. So they made an introduction. I went to see the editor-in-chief. I was excited just to see how they put the magazine together, to visit the offices in Milan. It's very exciting. And, of course, sat down, and this woman, totally, almost a mythic, iconic version of what you'd expect a fashion editor to be, you know, big glasses, tight leather, you know, and she flourished my portfolio in looking at it, and she went through it, and then she looked up and said, so when can you start? Well, that took me a little by surprise, but remaining cool, I said, well, I'm just going to go back and deliver these images for my client back in Toronto, and I shall return in 3 months. And in 3 months, I moved to Milan and had a studio at Vogue and worked for many years there. So that was the beginning of my fashion photography career. And it also led to me wanting to move to New York to actually make some money, because you may not know this, but when you're a fashion photographer, you're living high on the hog. You're traveling all over the world. It's great. It's fabulous. But they're paying you by the page. It's prestige, but it's not income. The income comes with a dynamic portfolio that the agencies then hire you to do real commercial work. And most of that was in the high-paying stuff was in New York. And so back and forth from New York. And really, that's where I really felt I needed to be. I knew the city very, very well. I had relatives there. And so I wanted to move back to New York, but I wanted to move permanently. So in applying for my green card at the time, I had to move back to Toronto and wait for, you know, I guess a couple of years before it processed. But that was good because I met my wife there. So that worked out pretty well. And there, I had worked internationally, I had no problem working. And around that time, I was jonesing to start to do more motion work. And I thought, well, the best place to learn how to do motion work is to just take what I have achieved here in still photography and make it in film, like just do fashion commercials. And so I started to beat the drum and was meeting commercial production houses and walking in with my portfolio and going, hey, I'll sweep the floors. I just want to learn how to do it. Well, they looked at my work, and I had just a lot of good fortune and people who took a shot on me and said, we will guarantee you, say, 40 days or 30, 40 days of directing at X amount of money, but you have to stop being a photographer. We want it to be clear, you're a director, and that's how we want to present you. Okay. I said yes. I started to do fashion commercials, and that just lit up like wildfire. So my situation improved at immigration. I got my green card. I married my wife, got married in a fever, opened a bar, had all my friends, and then the next week, we moved to New York. Of course, the irony is we're still together, so there you go. In New York, I worked with a company that I eventually became somewhat of a partner in commercials, and that really exploded my commercial career in New York, and lived there for several years. but worked so much in Los Angeles that I was back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and thought, well, I think the universe is telling me something. So I moved to Los Angeles. Of course, as soon as I moved here, I was asked to do a series of commercials on I Love New York. So I had to go back to New York. But it was good. I worked with Gordon Willis, and we had a phenomenal run, and came back here, and that was that. And over the years, my commercials were discovered by some, by many, and I was given a chance to direct a feature film, first one being Christmas Vacation.
Hey, Streetwalkers. Here's a word from our sponsors.
It is 2140. You are trapped in an underground bunker, built a century ago to protect mankind from the pandemic on the surface. Now ruled by tyrants and their robot army. You are an outcast, an orphan, a scavenger, blind, afraid, and alone. You are Ace, a survivor. And you will try to escape this place. This place known as Subterra. Subscribe to Subterra at iTunes, Spotify, or wherever you download podcasts.
Let's get back into it.
Now, I'm sure that it happens a lot, but the only other person that I can name who went from directing commercials to directing like big feature films is Mick G. And I might be wrong. That might have been music videos. I could be a little bit off on that.
Yeah, it was music videos. Yeah, I know Mick G. Yeah.
Of course you do.
But that was much later. There was one person before me who came out of that commercial world that I knew of. But it was early, and Warner's took a real shot with me. They were wind in my sails. My experience on the film was really, it was intense. But from the studio point of view, it was great. John Hughes was my producer. So I learned a tremendous amount about comedy. And all the while I'm doing that, I'm also doing my photography, my creative personal work, but not putting it out there at all. Because, you know, I'm a one-trick pony in terms of, at that point, trying to, you know, achieve some kind of longevity in the film business. And that began my career, such as it is, in film.
You said that Warner Brothers took a shot on you. Why?
Well, I'll speak for them, though, you know, I'm sure there's a lot of different reasons if you ask a lot of people. But some of the commercials that I had done, one in particular, or several in particular, had been just mentioned in passing by Stanley Kubrick, who was receiving tapes every week. Tapes, remember those? He was a big football fan and had the tapes of the games sent to him in London. And of course, the commercials were there as well. Anyway, he had seen, I think it was a Michelob commercial or some Michelob commercials that I had done. And just mentioned that in an interview he was doing for a film. And I didn't know this, but he was close with Steven Spielberg, Kathy Kennedy, those guys. And at some point they called me up and said, listen, you know, we like your commercial. Steven said every time he sees a commercial lately, it's your name attached as director. So why don't you come in and meet and we'll see what we can cook up. So went to Amblin and met them. It was a great, heady experience, but very grounded because they are very grounded people. And walked out with, I guess, with a deal there. And the deal was to do a small movie, which I wanted to do, on the Apollo Theater in New York. Basically, a version of kind of reality and scripted that took place on the stage of Amateur Night at the Apollo, which at that time had never really been done. And people didn't really, outside of Harlem, really had a great awareness of how many stars came out of that and what the power of the culture was. I mean, now it'd be kind of almost ironic to have a white Jew from Montreal come and say, I'm gonna make a show about the Apollo Theater. But I went to New York and spent months and months and months backstage at the Apollo and again developed relationships that are still active today. Ralph Cooper, who really founded Amateur Night at the Apollo and who now passed on, but he was like a fantastic kind of great uncle to me. And his son, Ralph Cooper Jr., is still a friend. But what happened is we developed this, and I pulled in a lot of my relationships that I developed over the course of making commercials. So I had a really A team to do. I wanted it to be small and contained because I didn't want a lot of interference. But just maybe a couple of months or a month or so before we're going to start, the head of studio at that time, Terry Semmel, had me in the office and said, "Look, Jeremiah, this is so good. Why are we doing such a small movie? Let's make a big movie. Let's blow this thing up. Let's make it with like movie stars. I mean, you know, we'll get Whitney Houston." And he said, "You know, you've worked with her." I had on, I think it was Diet Coke commercials. And he said, "I'll get Eddie Murphy and we'll just do this big thing." And I said, "But this is about amateurs. In other words, if I know they are going to succeed because they have so much talent as baggage, there's not going to be the drama that exists at the Apollo of even people who are great often get booed off the stage, or people who are somewhat empathetic with the audience get cheered. I mean, it's just a dazzler of a cultural basket there." And I think the key for me was, didn't feel it would work. And so I said, "Terry, I don't want to do that movie." And so he said, "Well, we're going to develop it anyway." And develop it they tried to do. Of course, years later, maybe 2 years later, they came back and said, "No, I think you were right. It should be a smaller movie." It just didn't really gel. But by then, the Apollo had changed hands, and Amateur Night at the Apollo became a TV series. And the magic of it, I felt, was lost, and its time had passed. But my relationships at Warner's with all the executives really had strengthened over that course, you know, of a year or so. And remember that I was working under the auspices of Amblin, so I had a 900-pound gorilla. And, you know, Steven had done Empire of the Sun, and he didn't want to pull the movie from them. I forget all of the politics there. But the happy ending was that the executive said to me, "Hey, we think you're really ready for a movie. We're just going to send you stuff and hopefully you'll like stuff." So they start sending me script after script after script. And I didn't like them. I mean, one of the scripts, they said, "Oh, you know, Clint Eastwood is going to do this. It's going to be really, really good. It's funny. It's right up your alley." And so I read the script and I went, "Man, there's no way Clint Eastwood is ever going to make a movie called Pink Cadillac. I mean, it's just not going to happen." Of course, naive as I was, they were sending me their slate. But one of the things they sent me was John Hughes's script for Christmas Vacation. And that blew my mind. It was so good right off the page. And I had never done any comedy. You know, I was kind of known for like cool, underlit, hard compositions, long lenses, sexy, fast cutting. And now like, what? A broad comedy in the style of Courier Knives? I mean, hell. But embrace it I did. I remember speaking to Kathy Kennedy and going like, "What am I going to do? I mean, it's like a Chevy Chase movie." I hadn't even seen first two Vacation movies. And dare I say, I still haven't. but for good reason, by the way, which I'll explain. But I read the script, and the script came out of a short story that John had written. The script was based on I think it was called Christmas 58 or Christmas 57. And it was really a story about a man who destroys his entire life trying to make the happiest Christmas for his family. And it was just a great idea. And it was written as a standalone. I'm not sure if he wrote the script as a standalone first, and then the studio asked him to kind of readapt it for the Vacation series for Lampoon. But what arrived for me was that, Christmas Vacation. And I thought, well, I don't want to approach it as a sequel. I'm going to approach it as an original movie. So that was my pitch. John and I got on great, which is saying a lot. And the studio already liked me. Chevy wanted me because I was kind of a breath of fresh air, not just kind of another guy doing another comedy. So I was given the keys to the kingdom. And luckily for me, John was shooting, I think, Uncle Buck. I can't really remember exactly what it was. So he went back to Chicago and left me with the reins to this movie. And when I had any real issues in terms of politics, I would just call him and say, "You know, they really want to take the cat out. So they're going to call you. Don't take the call." So he was just fantastic. And pretty much I cast all the actors I wanted. You know, who would have thought Johnny Galecki would be one of the highest paid actors in Hollywood? But there he is. And a wonder that he is. He's so great. And, you know, he was just a little kid. But off I went. There's a lot of stories surrounding that that I'm sure you can find on other podcasts. But film turned out well. And then I made another one. You know, it's just capitalizing on things that came before.
Now, I heard a rumor that you took over Christmas Vacation from Chris Columbus because Chris couldn't get along with Chevy. So that's not true?
No, that's not true. He was in the mix. This is what I heard. He was in the mix before they hired a director. Chevy did not want Chris, though Chris is a big talent. And I didn't know him or anything like that. But this happens all the time. You know, the studio is going to make a movie. They're not just fixated on a single director. They're going to go, oh, maybe we should get Chris Columbus. He did Adventures in Babysitting for us. You know, he did a pretty good job. And we don't know. Jeremiah's done nothing. And then other people would go, yeah, I think we need a fresh eye for this third, you know, version of Lampoon. And, you know, they hadn't spoken to me yet. But I went and I pitched my vision of the film and I brought a lot of visual aids and really kind of spelled out the kind of music I wanted. And they went, no, let's give it to me. But no, I didn't take over from him. You know, from the beginning, it was my movie.
Oh, cool. So instead of being a Jewish person from Montreal who did the Apollo thing, instead, you were a Jewish person from Montreal who did a Christmas movie.
There you go, as it should be.
Did you get any grief from your friends or family back home that you were going to do that your first big movie was a Christmas one?
No, hell no. We were very secular, not very religious.
Gotcha. So real quick, now John Hughes wrote Christmas Vacation, and I understand that you previously and currently were a John Hughes fan. So what was your favorite John Hughes movie before that and why? Your favorite one that you didn't direct?
You mean of his later work or his early work? Like I thought Home Alone is just an amazing movie. Home Alone is great. I have a friend of mine, Catherine O'Hara's in that, and it's just the construct of it is pretty fantastic. Of course, The Breakfast Club. I mean, come on, you know? The Breakfast Club is equally a classic and not what I would consider a comedy. You know, Home Alone is a broad comedy set in a home, a bottle show, we would call it. But so is Breakfast Club. And so maybe Breakfast Club is my favorite John Hughes. His body of work is amazing. He's the fastest typist I've ever seen in my life. I mean, I couldn't follow the screen. It would be like one of those sci-fi movies where they're hacking something and images are streaming. The numbers are streaming on the screen. That's how fast he typed. But John just had a gift for the kind of root base of comedy, where it kind of comes from, not just gags. He's good at broad, but he was also good at the emotive value of what people needed in every scene. And, you know, he captivated me by that.
Eventually, well, actually, word on the street is that of all of the rumors about how difficult it is to work with Chevy Chase, he's not even the one who gave you the most grief on set. Is that right? You don't have to say a name, but it wasn't even him.
No, definitely no. I got along great with Chevy. I got along great with everybody on the movie except for Beverly. By the way, I say this because Beverly knows we've since way made up. Let me give you the short without getting into the weeds, but her and I fought the entire movie. I remember the very first time I gave her a note, which was early in the film, and she just was like, what the fuck do you know? You've never directed anything. You know what I mean? I've worked with Scorsese and Schlesinger and blah, 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 blah. And it is in front of the whole crew. And I'm like, oh, God. But then my filmic history clicked in. I'm thinking, what if I'm William Wyler? What if this is Betty Davis? Right? I'd have to deal with this. And deal I did. I said nothing. I started to cover the scene. I covered the kids. I covered the grandparents. I covered Chevy. And then I went up to Beverly as if I was going to cover her. And I said, moving on. Well, that didn't go down too well. She said, you need my coverage. And I said, listen, I'm not going to cover you because I'm going to make you an extra if you behave like this. Anyway, she was good for a couple of weeks. Then we had another fight. She walked off. Then she came back. Studio threatened to sue her. Anyway, one thing after another. She was kind of upset about being there, and she took it out on me because I was a good punching bag. You know, Beverly's a wonderful actress, really gifted, very strong, good technique and a real force. And there she was making a broad comedy, which I think she felt kind of beneath her. I don't feel that any of us think that now that the movie has kind of achieved some kind of classic sense. I hesitate to kind of compliment my own work in that way, but it seems to have lasted generationally.
Definitely holds up.
But I remember when we were making the cast narrative on a Laserdisc or a CD-ROM or whatever we used to do there to kind of fill in stuff. Beverly and I had the greatest time ever together. It was like she was like, oh, I treated you badly. I said, that was like great. Because, you know, having that experience as a director is okay. You're going to face it all. You just have to do it with aplomb and not be mean and be very clear about what you need, but not be cowed, because if you can't control the set, you're not really directing the movie. But I think she's great. And this was so long ago. And, you know, people go through stages of their relationship with their craft. And that was just a stage. She's done great work since.
She is an amazing actress, and she has done a ton of great work. So
I agree.
It's good to hear that you guys are friends again.
Yeah, I'm not. I don't see her. You know, I haven't seen her in a dog's age. I saw her more when I was living in New York. But no, if our paths cross, it would be warm, I'm sure.
Well, that is good to hear. One of the other movies that you did, and this is actually what made me reach out to you. Last weekend, my wife and I had a friend over, and just for no reason, that friend brought a gift, you know, like a, you know, thanks for inviting me over gift. And that gift was one of her favorite movies ever, which was Benny and June. And so she gave us the Blu-ray of Benny and June, and I had seen it before back in the day, and my wife hadn't. So that night, which was Sunday, as soon as that friend left, we threw it in and started watching it. And that's why I reached out to you, is because I was like, oh my gosh, I forgot how much I love this movie. I should reach out to Jeremiah and see if he'd be willing to come on. So thank you for that. And now I want to talk about Benny and June. Benny and June came out, I think it was in 1993, and it stars Johnny Depp and Mary Stuart Masterson.
And Aidan Quinn.
And, you know, a bunch of other people that you recognize, like, you're going to go, oh my gosh, that dude. And oh my gosh, that dude. And it's really turned into fairly an all-star cast.
Pretty much.
Julianne Moore before anybody knew her name.
Yeah.
I mean, it's great.
Yeah.
And the guy, I can't remember his name. Oliver Platt. Thank you so much. So in this film, this is one of Johnny Depp's, it was probably like his eighth film or something, but it was still before, it was when he was on his rise. And so you contributed to making him one of the biggest stars in the world. And I want to know, did you see any of that? Much like Johnny Galecki in Christmas Vacation, did you see that spark in Johnny Depp? Like, did you know he was going to be as big as he turned out to be?
Well, there's a kind of a split screen answer to this. I don't really think in terms of like bigness ascribed by commercial success. You know, if you get lucky and you're in a lot of hits, you become big, because the measure of big or bankable is directly attributed to the amount of box office globally that the movies you are in generate.
Right.
So there you go. But did I think he was one of the most dazzling performers ever? Did I think that he was going to go far as an artist? Absolutely. No question. Every day. I love the man. I think he is phenomenal. I can't say enough good.
Awesome. His performance in that movie, I mean, there are scenes that, much like Christmas Vacation, there are scenes that will live on forever. Like, for instance, when she presented us with that Blu-ray, I said, oh my gosh, I love that movie. And then I did the fork in the roll thing from the diner, like just on the counter. I was like, you remember this movie, blah, blah, blah. So like, I mean, there's things in these movies that are going to last longer than anybody who was affiliated with them. So well done. That is tops. Like, it is really one of the best movies from the 90s, if I had to describe the 90s.
Well, you're being very kind. There's a lot of work in that movie and a lot of work on Johnny's part in terms of rehearsing, etc.
Sure.
And, you know, before we made the movie, we studied, there was an old movie theater here, the Silent Movie House. You know, I don't think it's in existence anymore, but they had an incredible collection of silent movies and also had incredible relationships with a lot of the estates of silent movie stars. And so, you know, the studio was nice enough. Alan Ladd Jr. was running the studio, and he was nice enough to allow us to basically take over the theater in the afternoon. Him and I would sit and watch silent movies of our favorites projected with an organist, the two of us. We watched hours of it, and it informed a tremendous amount of dynamics, me in terms of direction and staging, him in terms of performance. And he rehearsed the hell out of all of his, you know, physical scenes, worked very, very hard. The film itself was one of the most extraordinary experiences of my life in terms of its positive nature. Every single day on the set was a joy. And I don't say that just because the actors were joyful. The actors wanted to be there, but the crew wanted to be there. And we were all of a notion.
Hey, Streetwalkers. Here's a word from our sponsors.
Hey, guys. If you're like me, quarantine or not, you and your family are looking for new things to do together that don't involve staring at a screen. I have the perfect solution. It's a new trivia game called You Know It, and it's a blast, and you can try it for free. You Know It was created by John Sylvain, one of the hosts of the Nooner podcast on Kevin Smith's Smodcast podcast network. And since I'm a fan of that podcast, I signed up for an early copy when John launched his Kickstarter campaign. Really, I just wanted to be supportive, but my family and I played the game, and we loved it. Days later, everybody kept saying how fun it was. It's a very simple game. The rules are even simpler than Trivial Pursuit, but there's a lot of strategy to it as well, and the questions are fun and interesting and sometimes hilarious. And all of the questions have two parts. So maybe you don't know the first part, but maybe you know the second part, or vice versa, like this one. What name is shared by a California NBA team and a California NHL team? The Kings. They're not all easy like that, but some of them are. There's wild cards and strategy and stealing and even consequences for getting an answer wrong. One of my favorite parts about this game is that there's three questions on each card, three rounds plus maybe a tiebreaker for each game. Like when me and my family played, there was four of us, and it took 45 minutes to an hour. And we only used six cards, and there's so many cards. We could play this game forever. Now, I'm not suggesting that you have to be drinking to play this game, but me and my family were, and I tell you what, it raises the fun level to 11. I highly recommend you try it, and you can do that for free by going to youknowitthegame.com, all one word, no spaces, and you can download and print a starter pack for free. There's also more cards available for science and sports, and even a special Generation Z pack. And if free isn't cheap enough for you, Streetwalkers can get 30% off on all other downloadable packs by using the discount code FSTREET at checkout. Once again, that's youknowitthegame.com, all one word, no spaces, and use the discount code FSTREET at checkout for 30% off all other downloadable packs. And if I'm being honest, Streetwalkers, I'm a little upset that I only got one copy of this game. My kids are adults, and they deserve a copy of this game so they can play with their friends too. Remember, the game is called You Know It, and it's a blast.
Let's get back into it.
I don't know. We were all in Spokane, Washington, which did not have a tremendous amount of film experience. I think there was one film that they had made there before. So people weren't used to film crews and whatnot. And the neighborhoods used to come out at night and bring their lawn chairs and watch us film and then bring muffins and things like that. And every weekend, you know, when we wrapped, we'd have a rotating party that, you know, at my house or where one of the crew would be staying. Or we kept a bond, the crew and the cast, together. I remember letting the film roll out on the very last take. It was the three of them in the park, and Aiden is stepping over a park bench, which tips. It's the very last thing I shot on that. And he did it, and it was just a beautiful, we were looking at it through the eyes of a very long lens, and they were kind of maybe 50 feet away from me, and we were on the ground, camera crew and grips and stuff. And I just could not say cut. I just let it roll out, and I looked around, and everyone, we all had tears in our eyes. It was a profound moment because we knew It was lightning in a bottle, the experience of shooting it. Of course, when I came back to LA and started cutting with Carol Littleton, who's one of the giant editors that we have in the world, I said, listen, I had such a great time shooting it. Now I know it's going to turn into a piece of shit. I was convinced it wouldn't work because tonally, I didn't have anything to compare it to reference it.
Right.
You know, it's its own thing tonally. There's real tragedy in it, and there's real comedy in it. There's physical comedy. There's dynamic. There's drama. There's, you know, melodrama. It mixes a lot of metaphors, and keeping that balance in my head was joy to do, but it was a delicate poet, you know. It was a delicate poetic experience to just manage this very delicate thing. Started cutting it, and I remember being absolutely flipped the very first time that we screened it in a preview screening just to get some reaction. I was so convinced it was just going to just die. But as the movie started to play and you just felt the audience like just come alive and really reach into the movie, you could feel it. And I kept turning to the editor and saying, yeah, but wait till the end. They're going to drop the ball. I know it. I don't know why I was so fearful about it, but I was. It was my second movie. I had so much good feelings and I loved it so much. I was hoping that it just would be okay. And, you know, the movie landed and the audience just loved, loved, loved it. And it was, wow, it was just a great experience. And then Rachel Portman did the most fantastic score. We worked really, really hard on that to create, again, a score that often copied, you know, since then. But it's a very kind of circus-like score in many ways, calliope-driven in some ways. But the notion of it was very, very sweet and very quirky. And just a fantastic kind of thread to weave with these giant actors, great actors, all of them.
Now, you mentioned a lot of the different tones that are in that movie, but what I didn't hear was love or heart. That movie,
well,
it has a lot of heart, but it's about love in so many different variations of love. Sort of the way Frozen was about love, but not the love you thought.
Yeah, I see that, but I didn't say it for, I mean, you can't direct a movie, you know, say, okay, we're this is our scene where we're going to do a lot. There'll be a lot of love in this scene. You know, that I think the love is the grout that holds everything together. And I think part of it is certainly the script. Part of it is the way that the cast interacted and supported each other. But also, you feel the love from the crew in capturing these things. There's just something magical. You could just feel that, this relationship between performer and, I don't want to say just the director, but it was all of us just focused on this, on what they were doing. And the script was strong. We worked on it forever. A lot of changes from the original. But at the end of the day, it was the performers themselves who gave so much. Example, there was a scene where Aidan and Mary Stewart they're in a room, they're discussing something, and Johnny's character is peeking in through the door, and they look up and they see him watching them. And I had shot Johnny's kind of peeking in. And then, the day was over and we were going to kind of come around the next day and shoot Aidan and Mary Stewart. And Johnny would have the day off on a normal film set. It's like, yeah, I'm going to fly to Nebraska or whatever. But on that day, I said to Johnny, you've got the day off. Aidan and Mary Stewart, they were like, no, we don't need you off stage for us to look and see you. It's just one moment. You know what I mean? No, take the day off and relax and catch up on sleep and all the rest. Not only did he refuse, but he came to the set, got in full makeup and costume just to stand in their eyeline so that they could look at him.
That's unheard of.
That is a tribute to who he is, his generosity, and his gift. You know, that's what I'm saying. It was that kind of shoot.
Wow. That's amazing. So I've interviewed Paul Feig a couple of times, and every time I interview him, I ask him what happened to some of the art from his films, like particularly from his last two films, A Simple Favor and Last Christmas. So in Benny and June, Mary Stuart Masterson made paintings. What happened to those paintings? Do you have them?
No, I don't. I don't know what happened to them. Really don't. I mean, I assume that some of them probably got trashed. Some of them were probably taken by the art department. Maybe some of them went to the painter who actually painted them at some point, or who helped Mary Stuart with that style. I feel that's what happened. In other words, they went back to the original artist as a keepsake. But I don't know is the real answer.
Gotcha. A little birdie told me that you also have a podcast. What is it called? What is it about? And where can we find it?
Well, it's called The Future of Photography, and you can find it anywhere.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
What made you do a podcast about a visual medium?
You know, we've been talking about film, but, you know, in equal and opposite, or certainly in many ways, more now than ever, you know, I find myself falling into where I began as a visual artist with very little noise around me doing my own work. And, you know, my website has a tremendous amount of the work there. But about a year ago, I had a solo show here in LA. I had a museum show about a year and a half ago in Buenos Aires at the Museum of Architecture and Design.
Wow.
I'm working on a book of my work with Nazarelli Press, a very fine art publisher. So that really is, in many ways, it is very much who I am as well. I take my work very seriously, and I work at it daily when I'm not directing or writing. And that provides me with the level of sanity that helps me bear the current world state. So my work as an artist is, in so many ways, a more important legacy for me. And as a result of that, it's very much about digital art, or uses a lot of digital art tropes. And the work really flows from a very, very kind of different place than my filmmaking, whether it's filmmaking or television making.
Gotcha. So you directed the films National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, Benny and June, Diabolique, The Avengers, no, not that one, a different one. You also have directed a ton of TV.
Yeah.
Gossip Girl, The Gifted, Rogue, The Glades, which, by the way, I watched every single episode, and I'm still waiting for them to fix the ending of that show. Heart of Dixie, Chuck, Leverage, Shadowhunt. I could go on forever, but we only have so much time. But in all of the things that you've done in moving pictures, what is your favorite memory of anything you've done? Favorite on-set memory of any of those projects?
Oh, you know, I would say that there's so many that I
could. There has to be.
Really?
Yeah, there has to be.
Well, don't know that. I would say one of my favorite experiences on a movie set is in probably my worst movie ever, which there's a lot of reasons why it turned out so badly, and I'll take all the blame, but it was a lot more complicated. But The Avengers, no, not that one. Ralph Fiennes and Sean Connery were doing a fight scene. We were drenched. It was indoors at Shepperton Studios. We were creating a storm indoors. It was a huge set, massive rain. A lot of fun. It was kind of a fun shoot. And Rafe and I looked at each other, and he mouthed to me, "Can you believe we're working with Sean Connery?" you know, later on that day, Rafe's birthday was coming up, and I asked Sean to look into the camera, and I rolled the camera and give me a Bond, James Bond. And he did. Happy birthday, Rafe. And that was one of the happiest moments. You know, it was just sort of full circle of being in with Connery, of who I've spent 5 months with, working with on the show. But the interesting thing about it, just in terms of film, is one of my earliest conscious experience of seeing a movie was with my father when we went to see Dr. No. And it literally blew my mind. It would change my life. I said, oh, that's what movies are about. There you go.
At the time that you got to shoot The Avengers with Sean, or Sir Connery, was your father still alive to see that happen?
No. No, long dead. Yeah.
Oh, man. Okay. Well, Jeremiah, as we're heading out, is there anything I didn't ask you or that we didn't talk about that you wanted to talk about?
We didn't talk about television. We didn't talk about art. We didn't talk about photography, you know. So we've basically talked about, you know, like 30% of what I've done or what I do. And that's fine. I'm not here to write a bio. or anything like that.
That means part two in a few months.
Maybe it could be boring for your audience. We'll see how much hate mail you get.
So funny.
What an asshole that guy is.
Jeremiah, as we head out, will you hit the name of your podcast one more time and then tell people where they can find you on social media?
The Future of Photography.
The Future of Photography.
And I am on Instagram, Jeremiah_Chechik. My website is Chechik.com, Chechik.com. Twitter, I'm Tinroof.
Tinroof, gotcha.
And I don't really use Facebook, so it's not an issue. That's enough social media, don't you think?
Well, apparently they're making new ones every day.
I don't do TikTok because, okay, boomer, right?
That's right. That's so funny.
They won't let me on. They won't let me on. The website has really the connective to all of the social media stuff, but the podcast is rather fun. We do it weekly, drops on Wednesdays, and it's me and my kind of partners in crime. I'll send you a link for what it is, but it's great. And it's astonishingly difficult to put together. I don't. Chris Marquardt, he does Tips from the Top Floor as well, another podcast on photography. He runs it out of Germany. And then Adrian is in England and Emer is in Ireland and I'm here. So just scheduling it is always a chore. And we all get together. We all record these conversations. Sometimes it's only two, three, but often it's four. And we go through a subject and we talk about its relevance to the future of the medium. And it's a lot of fun. And if you're into photography, of course, it's good because we talk about philosophical things. We also talk about gear. We talk about just the practicalities of things. We, you know, talk about recommended artists. We're all very different in our approaches to the medium as well.
That sounds fascinating. I can't wait to check it out. Make sure to send me that link.
I will.
Also, scroll down, folks. I will put that link in the show notes as well as Jeremiah's social media tag so that you can reach out and tell him how much you enjoyed this episode. And with that, Jeremiah Chechik, thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy day and your schedule to let us get to know you a little bit better on Fascination Street. It was a real honor, and I was really, really happy to talk to you, man. Thank you so much.
Flattery will get you everywhere. Thank you.
Thanks, Jeremiah. You have a great rest of your week, man.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. As always, thanks for listening, Streetwalkers. And don't forget, follow the show on Twitter at FascinationSTPD, on Instagram at FascinationStreetPod. Follow the podcast page on Facebook at FascinationStreetPodcast. And of course, you can always email me at FascinationStreetPod@gmail.com. And if you haven't already, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button and rate us on iTunes.
Subterra, Episode 1.
From his hiding place in a rocky alcove, high above the square, Ace watched the busy market. Hundreds of people, citizens and vendors, were down there, buying goods, trading goods, laughing, arguing, and going about their business, completely unaware that Ace was watching them. Ace was used to hiding in the shadows. He was a bunker orphan, an outcast. He never felt welcome in the chute, and the other facilities of Subterra were also off-limits to him and the other outcasts. But he needed to come here sometimes. There were things he needed that he couldn't find scavenging in the barrens or the lower levels. So here he was, on market day. Ace wore a ragged, dirty jumpsuit. A backpack was slung over his shoulder. His eyes were hidden by his optics goggles, the most expensive item he owned. Without his goggles, Ace had a hard time seeing anything. He guessed most people would have called him blind. Though he could see things without his goggles, things were fuzzy and dim. The goggles were necessary, and without them, he might as well be dead. He adjusted his goggles and locked in on the spare parts vendor. He was an older man, about 50, dressed in simple robes, and he was haggling with the younger man over the price of a broken ventilator mask.
No, it works fine.
The stall had shelves that were packed with various parts, and most of them looked like junk. Most of them were junk. but there was one item that Ace keyed on, a power pack resting on the top shelf. That was what he was there for. Ace saw that the market was brightly lit. He looked up, but there was no sky overhead. There was a crosshatch of steel beams that ran the length of a large rocky ceiling. There were three xenon lights that ran the length of the large chamber. They produced a soft but very radiant light that illuminated the entire square. In theory, they were almost as powerful as the sun, producing almost 80,000 lux. But that was just theory and hearsay. Nobody had seen the sun for over 100 years. Ace turned his attention back to the market stalls. He had no money, nothing to barter with, at least nothing he wanted to part with, so he was going to steal it. The vendor was still arguing, waving his arms around wildly as he harangued the man who looked at the mask with a disapproving snarl on his lips. Ace switched to setting on his optics again and scanned the market, sweeping the area for signs of security. They were there, of course. Two sentries with a Mass 7 bot were standing next to a stall with a vendor selling some dehydrated fruit. He looked up and saw cameras embedded high up in the rock ceiling. There was no way for him to know if they were operational or not. But that didn't really matter. Nobody knew his face here. He wasn't chipped. There was no way for them to track him. He was going to have to deal with the Mass 7, though. It could track his heat signature, even in the dark. And if it got a hold of him, it was all over, and he would be finished. But he didn't really have any choice. He was finally getting out of this place. He was going to see the sun for the first time in his life. He had made his plans and theorized and put all of his supplies together. He was going to leave this place and never come back. Now it was time to do something about it, to take action. And it all started with that power pack. He slid over the edge of the rock shelf and lowered himself down until he was just holding onto the edge with his fingertips. Then he dropped a few feet to the next outcropping. He traversed the rock face carefully, pausing to make sure nobody was looking in his direction. Then made his way down to the market. He dropped the last few feet and landed on the mesh grate floor with a soft thud. He was behind one of the market tents, out of view from the vendors and other market patrons. He dusted himself off, pulled his cloak tightly around him, and flipped up his hood to hide his face. Then, he stepped out into the market. One way or another, this would all be over in a few minutes.
Subterra was created by Warren Davis and Steve Kruger. Performed by Marty Yu.
Opening music is the song Magnolia from the 2014 album Intransigence. Used with permission from Douglas Miles Clark. Closing music is Apollo from the 2001 album Into the Known by the band Sapphire. Thanks for hanging out with us and getting to know a little bit about our guest. We'll see you next time on Fascination Street.